The city lights blurred into streaks of neon anxiety as Phoenix Carrie drove home. Each red light felt like a taunt, a cruel reminder of the life draining away from him. The weight of bills, the sting of inflation, it all pressed down on him.
I wasn't a man prone to despair, but the rules had changed. My meager savings were evaporating faster than morning dew.
The thought of spending his golden years in a desperate struggle for survival filled him with dread. The number was a faded memory, scribbled on a napkin years ago. A friend of a friend, someone who knew people. Back then, it had seemed like a good idea, a safety net in a world of shadows. Now, bathed in the cold glow of his phone screen, it felt like a lifeline.
His finger hovered over the call button, his heart pounding like a drum solo in his chest. This was madness. Suicide? It was the coward's way out. But the alternative, a slow descent into poverty and despair, felt even more terrifying.
He closed his eyes, took a deep breath, and pressed the button. The ringing tone pierced the silence of his car, each beep a hammer blow against his mounting anxiety. Then, a voice, gruff and businesslike, cut through the tension.
Yeah?
I need a favor. A friend told me you could help, with something.
The words tasted like ash in his mouth. A confession of defeat and desperation. The voice on the other end of the line didn't betray any surprise, only a cold, pragmatic curiosity.
Depends on the favor, friend. What you got in mind?
I need to disappear.
He finally choked out, the words heavy with unspoken meaning. There was a long silence, broken only by the faint hum of traffic in the distance. Then, a low chuckle.
Disappearances are messy, friend. Expensive, too.
I can pay.
Phoenix blurted out, his voice gaining a desperate edge. He rattled off the pitiful sum he had left, his life savings, the fruits of years of toil. The voice on the other end remained impassive.
All right. Meet me tomorrow. Usual place, noon sharp. And bring something to write with.
The line went dead. Phoenix stared at the phone, his hand trembling. He was in too deep now. There was no turning back. Sleep that night was a cruel stranger. Images flickered behind his eyelids, faces of loved ones, memories both cherished and painful, all tinged with an undercurrent of regret and fear. He tossed and turned, the weight of his decision pressing down on him like a physical burden.
What had I done? Was this the answer? To choose oblivion over the struggle, to surrender to the darkness instead of fighting for a future that seemed increasingly bleak.
The thought of his family, of the pain his absence would inflict, tore at his heart.
But then, the cold reality of my situation would wash over me. The mounting bills, the shrinking bank balance, the fear of becoming a burden on those I loved. Was it selfish to choose peace for myself, even if it meant inflicting pain on others?
He didn't have the answers. All he had was a desperate hope that maybe, just maybe, this was the least terrible option in a sea of bad choices. The first rays of dawn found him still awake, his eyes bloodshot, his spirit as heavy as lead. The usual place turned out to be a dingy diner tucked away in a forgotten corner of the city. The air hung thick with the smell of stale coffee and greasy food, a fitting aroma for a meeting that reeked of desperation and despair.
Phoenix sat nervously in a booth by the window, his eyes darting around the room, searching for any sign of his contact. Every creak of the floorboards, every muffled conversation, sent shivers down his spine. He felt like a character in a bad noir film, trapped in a plot he didn't fully understand.
Just as his anxiety threatened to overwhelm him, a figure slid into the booth across from him. He was tall and wiry, with a face etched with the harsh lines of a life lived on the fringes. His eyes, cold and calculating, seemed to see right through Phoenix, stripping him bare.
You brought something to write with? The man rasped, his voice barely a whisper.
Phoenix fumbled in his pocket and produced a pen and a small notepad.
Good, the man said, a faint smile playing on his lips. Let's talk business.
As the man spoke, outlining the grim details of his retirement plan, a strange thing happened. The fear that had been gnawing at Phoenix's insides began to recede, replaced by a sliver of doubt.
The plan was simple, brutal, and terrifyingly final.
He thought of his family, of the life he was about to erase. Was he really willing to give it all up, to surrender to the darkness without a fight?
"So we got a deal?" he asked, his voice a low growl.
Phoenix hesitated, his hand hovering over the notepad. The pen felt heavy, like a judge's gavel poised to deliver a life-altering sentence.
The pen felt impossibly heavy in Phoenix's hand. It wasn't just a pen, it was a weapon, a tool of self-destruction. His breath caught in his throat, fear tightening in his chest. The diner noises faded as he stared at the blank notepad.
Across the table, the man watched with amusement and impatience. His eyes, cold and predatory, mocked Phoenix's hesitation. Just another transaction in a world where life and death were commodities.
He opened his eyes and looked at the man across the table. The man's expression hadn't changed. He was a statue of indifference, a grim reaper waiting patiently for his due.
"You got something to say?"
the man asked, his voice a low rumble.
There's got to be another way."
Phoenix took a shaky breath, the words caught in his throat, a jumble of fear, doubt, and a desperate longing for a different ending. His voice barely audible above the clatter of dishes and the murmur of distant conversations. The man leaned forward, a flicker of something akin to curiosity in his eyes.
"There's always another way, but most folks don't have the stomach for it."
He paused, letting the words hang in the air between them.
"What do you mean?"
Phoenix asked, his voice laced with a newfound urgency. A faint smile played on the man's lips.
"Let's just say there are other ways to disappear, ways that don't involve an early grave."
Intrigue warred with apprehension in Phoenix's gut. This wasn't the reprieve he'd envisioned, but a new path shrouded in uncertainty. The man, sensing his hesitation, leaned back and lit a cigarette, the glowing embers casting dancing shadows on his face.
"It's a different kind of deal, more of hands-on. You gotta be willing to get your hands dirty."
He looked at Phoenix, his eyes narrowed.
"The question is, how desperate are you to walk away from your life?"
Phoenix felt a chill crawl down his spine. This wasn't just about disappearing anymore. This was about transformation, about becoming someone he barely recognized. But what choice did he have? He had stared into the abyss, and the abyss had stared back.
"Tell me what I have to do."
He looked at the man, his voice firm despite the tremor in his chest. The man smiled, a slow, predatory grin that sent shivers down Phoenix's spine. He had just chosen a different kind of death, a slow, agonizing shedding of his former life. The question was, what would he become in its place? The diner, bathed in the pale light of noon, felt like a battleground. The air was thick with unspoken threats. Phoenix listened as the man laid out his proposition. It was a descent into the city's underbelly, a world of shadows and secrets. The man spoke of risky jobs and dangerous alliances. Phoenix's mind raced, trying to weigh the risks. He thought of his family, their faces blurred with love and disappointment.
"And what happens when it's over?"
"Then you disappear, just like we agreed."
Phoenix left the diner with a head full of dark possibilities and a heart heavy with doubt. The city, once familiar and comforting, now felt alien and threatening. He was a ghost haunting his own life, caught between a past he couldn't escape and a future he didn't dare imagine.
He drove home, the streets blurring into a kaleidoscope of neon and despair. As he pulled into his driveway, the first rays of dawn painted the sky in hues of orange and purple. He sat in his car, the engine idling, and stared at the house that held his life, his family. And in the stillness of that dawning day, Phoenix knew he couldn't outrun his fate.
The man from the diner, Silas, wasted no time. He became Phoenix's guide through the city's underworld. Phoenix was thrust into a world of darkened alleys and clandestine meetings.
Silas moved like a phantom, his network vast and intricate. Phoenix learned the art of picking locks and memorizing faces.
He met Silas's associates, each with their own tale of survival. They were all living on borrowed time, playing a high-stakes game. Silas Silas, a stern but surprisingly patient mentor, taught Phoenix the art of disappearing. He learned to shed his identity like a snake shedding its skin, adopting new names, new mannerisms, even a new way of walking.
Gone was the mild-mannered accountant, replaced by a hardened shell of a man, his eyes wary, his movements calculated. He learned to fight, his body becoming a weapon, his fists calloused and bruised. He learned to lie, his words smooth and convincing, hiding the turmoil that raged within.
He hated the man he was becoming, this phantom who moved through the city's underbelly. But hate was a luxury he could no longer afford.
He still hadn't asked Silas what his final job would be. The thought hung over him like a guillotine, a constant reminder of the price he would ultimately pay for his freedom. Survival, he was learning, was a full-time job.
The first job Silas gave him was small, almost insignificant. Deliver a package to a nondescript warehouse on the docks. Don't ask questions, don't look inside.
But as I drove through the rain-slicked streets, my heart pounded against my ribs. I felt the weight of the package on the passenger seat, a tangible reminder of the life I had chosen.
He saw his daughter's face in his mind's eye, her smile bright and innocent. He had made a promise to protect her, even if it meant sacrificing his own soul.
I would do this for her.
The warehouse loomed before him, a hulking silhouette against the storm clouds. He took a deep breath, grabbed the package, and stepped out into the pouring rain. The jobs escalated, each one pushing Phoenix further into the abyss. He became a collector, a bagman, a messenger in a world where information was currency and violence was the preferred method of negotiation.
I tried to justify my actions. I was doing this for my family, for their future. But the blood on my hands felt real, the guilt a lead weight in my stomach.
One night, after a particularly brutal encounter, he found himself staring at his reflection in a dirty bathroom mirror. The face staring back at him was a stranger, hardened, cynical, a world away from the hopeful young man he once was.
What had I become? Was this the man I was destined to be?
He slammed his fist against the mirror, the shattered glass a metaphor for his fractured life. He wanted to scream, to weep, to claw at his skin and tear away this monstrous reflection. But all he felt was a numbing emptiness, a chilling acceptance of the darkness that had consumed him. Time lost all meaning. Days bled into weeks, weeks into months. Phoenix became a creature of habit, his life a cycle of violence and paranoia, punctuated by fleeting moments of quiet desperation.
I rarely saw my family. I would call, my voice strained and unfamiliar, making excuses, spinning lies that tasted like poison on my tongue.
He clung to those calls, those brief glimpses into the life he had left behind, as a drowning man clings to a piece of driftwood.
One day, Silas summoned me. "It's time," he said, a grim smile playing on his lips. I felt a surge of dread mixed with a perverse sense of relief. The moment I had been dreading and anticipating had finally arrived.
He knew what it meant. The final job, the ultimate test.
I had to face it, no matter the cost. Survival demanded it.
Don't open it until you're ready. This is your ticket out, your chance to disappear.
Phoenix took the envelope, his fingers trembling. He knew what it contained, his own death warrant. He looked at Silas, his eyes searching the man's face for a flicker of remorse, a hint of compassion, but there was nothing. He left Silas's presence and walked into the night, the city lights blurring into a kaleidoscope of fear and uncertainty. He had survived, but at what cost? He had become the very thing he had sought to escape, a ghost haunting the fringes of his own life. He found himself standing on a bridge, the city lights twinkling below like a sea of broken promises. He took the envelope from his pocket and looked at the address scrawled on the front, Phoenix Carey. He had come full circle, the man he once was, the life he had tried to outrun. It was all here, contained within this single fateful envelope.
As I stood on the precipice, I knew I had one final choice to make.
The wind whipped at his face, urging him to decide. The cold steel of the bridge railing bit into Phoenix's palms as he stared into the dizzying abyss below. The city lights, once symbols of ambition and possibility, now mocked him with their distant, indifferent glow.
I clutched the envelope, its edges softened by my clammy grip.
He could end it all right here, right now. A clean break, a final disappearance. Silas would ensure his family received the payout, a blood-soaked pension to ease their pain. The thought of his family, their faces etched with grief, sent a fresh wave of nausea through him. He had promised to protect them, to shield them from the harsh realities of the world. Instead, he had become the embodiment of their worst fears, a phantom haunting their lives.
I closed my eyes, the wind whipping tears from beneath my lids.
He had sought to spare them from pain, but in his quest for survival, he had only amplified their suffering. As the wind carried the city's symphony of sirens and distant laughter towards him, a memory flickered through Phoenix's mind. He was young, his daughter a giggling toddler perched on his shoulders. That man seemed like a stranger now, a ghost from a life he had left behind.
But the memory, however fleeting, ignited a spark of defiance in my heart.
Gripped by a newfound resolve, Phoenix turned away from the edge. The city lights no longer seemed so distant, the wind no longer so cold.
I had spent months running from my past, but in that moment, I realized the only way forward was to confront it.
He pulled out his phone, the screen illuminating his face with a ghostly glow. The battery was low, the signal weak, but it was enough. He had one call to make, one last chance to reclaim the life that had slipped through his fingers. The phone rang once, twice, each beep a hammer blow against his mounting anxiety. Just when he was about to give up hope, a voice, filled with sleep-slurred concern, answered.
Phoenix, is that you?
His wife's voice, tinged with worry and a flicker of cautious hope, was the lifeline he had been clinging to without even realizing it.
It's me. I need to see you. I need to tell you everything. The journey back from the abyss was long and arduous. Confessing my sins to my wife was the hardest thing I had ever done.
Her reaction was not anger, but a heartbroken sadness that cut him to the core. He saw the pain in her eyes, the betrayal that mirrored his own.
She made me promise to turn myself in, to face the consequences of my actions. It was a price I was willing to pay.
The police were waiting for him at their doorstep. As he was led away in handcuffs, he looked back at his wife, his eyes pleading for forgiveness. She didn't smile, but he saw a flicker of hope in her gaze, a silent promise that she would be there for him, waiting for the day he could finally come home.
I had spent months seeking a way out, but true freedom, I realized, lay in taking responsibility for my choices.
He had faced the consequences of his actions and emerged from the crucible of his past, ready to embrace the uncertain future, one step at a time.
The prison walls were cold and unforgiving, but they held a strange kind of solace.
He spent his days working in the prison library, surrounded by the stories of others who had stumbled and fallen. He read of redemption and forgiveness, of second chances and the enduring power of the human spirit.
I wrote to my wife and daughter every day, pouring out my remorse, my hopes, my dreams for a future where I could earn back their trust and love.
Their letters, filled with a tentative hope and unwavering support, became his lifeline, a beacon of light in the darkness.
Years passed, seasons turned. I emerged from prison a changed man.
He was no longer the man he once was, but he wasn't the ghost he had almost become either. He had a new name, a new life, but most importantly, he had a second chance.
I had stared into the abyss and found the strength to climb back, scarred but not broken.
He was ready to embrace the uncertain future, one step at a time.
I walked out of the prison gates a free man, but the weight of my past followed close behind, a shadow I knew I might never outrun.
His wife was there, her hair streaked with silver, but her eyes still held the warmth he remembered.
Our reunion was tentative, a fragile dance of forgiveness and apprehension.
His daughter, now a woman he barely recognized, refused to see him. The letters he had written, filled with apologies and desperate pleas for understanding, lay unanswered, a testament to the depth of her hurt.
I couldn't blame her. I had traded her childhood for my own survival, and the guilt gnawed at me like a hungry beast.
The world had moved on without him, the city a stranger with familiar scars. His reflection in the shop windows was a stranger too, his face etched with the harsh lines of regret and weary wisdom.
I yearned to reach out, to bridge the chasm, but the fear of further pain, hers and my own, held me back.
He had to find a way to heal, to rebuild the bridges he had burned.
Life after prison was a series of small victories and crushing defeats.
He found work as a janitor, his accounting skills rendered obsolete.
The pay was meager, the work humbling, but it gave me a sense of purpose.
One day he received a postcard. It was a picture of a mountain meadow. On the back, a single sentence in his daughter's familiar handwriting. Maybe it's time we talked. You can find more stories like this in Brain Boxing, available on Amazon or your local bookstore.
I held the postcard to my chest, my heart swelling with hope and trepidation. Keep an eye on my Rodney's publishing YouTube.